Okay, the next item of business is a debate on motion 11351 in the name of Mark Griffin on Scotland's housing emergency. I'd invite members wishing to participate in the debate to press the request to speak buttons. I can advise the Chamber that we have absolutely no time in hand, and therefore I will have to be enforcing the time limits on speeches pretty robustly. And with that, I call on Mark Griffin to speak to and move the motion up to 12 minutes. Mr Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Before we begin, I draw members' attention to my register of interest, which shows that I ceased to be a landlord over the summer. I'm pleased to open this debate for Labour today, using our business time to call on this Parliament and the Government to face up to reality, the reality facing thousands of families across the country, and declare a national housing emergency. Before we start, I want to thank this sector for their support for today's debate and the briefings they've provided. Scottish Land and Estates, Crisis, Homeless Network Scotland, amongst others, all recognising the urgency of the housing emergency, desperately wanting to see the Minister and the Government act today. In particular, thanks are due to Shelter for working across parties to support the debate as well. Today was meant to be about challenging this Government to take responsibility and deliver action to deal with this national emergency. And as much as the Minister may spend all afternoon trying to pin the responsibility on the economic illiteracy of the Tory Government at Westminster, this emergency has been made in Scotland, and it's his government and it's his responsibility to fix it. Now, sadly, the Minister isn't prepared to do what his SNP colleagues in Edinburgh and Argyll and Bute have faced up to. Yep, certainly.
John Swinney.
I'm grateful to Mr Griffin for giving way. He rather glided past the question of economic illiteracy in the United Kingdom government. Yeah. And I don't think it really helps the debate for Mr Griffin to obscure the fact that we are all living with the consequences of some absolutely devastating macroeconomic decisions made by the United Kingdom government over many years, but principally in the mini-budget last September. Would Mr Griffin just perhaps alight for a little bit more time on the economic illiteracy of the UK government?
Yeah. Mark Griffin.
My colleagues at Westminster have been highlighting that economic illiteracy and will sweep that government out of office and make changes for the betterment for this country. But what I want to talk about here is this government's responsibility, this government's action, or actually inaction, which has led to the housing emergency that it seems the entire country accepts we are in the grip of, apart from this government. And so we can't accept the amendment which denies that emergency. We can't accept an amendment that deflects and offers absolutely nothing new, because, Presiding Officer, the facts set out that we are in the grip of a housing crisis, and that is at a national scale. 9,500 children in temporary accommodation, many of them for up to a year. Homeless numbers, the highest on record. Another household made homeless every 16 minutes. By the time I've spoken and the Minister has spoken, there will be two more households made homeless in this country. 60,000 households at risk of repossession. 200,000 households languishing on waiting lists. And despite an emergency rent freeze, rents have rocketed 12% in Scotland in the last year, increasing faster than anywhere else. Now, earlier today, Anas Sarwar and I met with Shelter's helpline team, those on the front line supporting those being made homeless. Day in, day out, they're supporting people with nowhere else to turn, failed by councils who are ultimately running out of cash dealing with this housing emergency. We heard about the person sleeping in an out-of-use caravan in a mechanic's yard. No electricity, water or heating. When the council found out, they were told there was no accommodation available until a solicitor got involved. A woman with three children moved from hotel to hotel, forced to share a bedroom with her teenage children, and no adaptations provided for her child, who was in a wheelchair. And I think most shockingly, We heard of a woman who has been in temporary accommodation for 10 years. 10 years in a temporary accommodation. And what was worse, that woman has a six-year-old child. That six-year-old child has spent their entire life in temporary accommodation. That six-year-old has no concept of what a safe, secure place to call home is. That's an appalling indictment. And the fact that the government cannot accept that there is a housing emergency when we have people in circumstances like that is beyond belief. And my own inbox, like many others in the chamber today, is full of examples of families, children, younger and older people stuck without somewhere they can call home. The stories that I've got in that inbox, like I say, are repeated right across every part of the country, every day of the week. In recent weeks, I've heard from a woman who has COPD, whose home is making her ill. A young family that has cut spending to the absolute bone, but they are still a matter of weeks away from losing the roof over their heads. The teenager kicked out of their house, now couch surfing. Devastating and miserable examples of how desperately people are living in need of a home in Scotland today. But, Presiding Officer, rather than dealing with the scale of the problem, the government is systematically underestimating the country's needs. Councils have been set the task to find land for a minimum 200,000 homes over the next decade. And you would think that 200,000 would make a dent in this housing emergency, but only if that was the right number. New data revealed last week by Homes for Scotland at their conference, which the Minister attended, would terrify any responsible government into action, but it seems not this government. Now, they're concerned that local development planning guidance will drastically underestimate real housing needs, so they've commissioned a primary research-led report into the true housing need in Scotland to support planners. Because counting the number in the most extreme circumstances, only measuring those in overcrowded and concealed households and those in homeless temporary accommodation, ignores that full picture. Their survey of 14,000 Scottish households finds that 28% of Scottish households, that means 700,000, have some form of housing need, far, far higher than the official 200,000 estimate. Yep, I will.
Kate Forbes.
I thank the member for taking the intervention, and as I will say later on, I have some sympathy with the scale of the challenge. But of course, real leadership requires sound policies to resolve it. The SNP have built, I believe, 124,000 social and affordable homes since 2007. What would Labour do?
Mark Griffin.
We would build more. Labour's record in government, we built an average of 5,000 houses more every single year in office than this government has managed to do. That is the culmination, that is the cause of Scotland's housing crisis, a shortage in supply that has been overseen by this government's failure to deliver the houses that we need. That's been evidenced by those right across the sector, Homes for Scotland, Shelter, a whole range of organisations who specialise in it, have said that consistently this government have failed to deliver the housing numbers that this country needs. Now, whoever you do speak to, whether it is Shelter, Homes for Scotland, housing conveners across the country, they've all been told that the minister is in listening mode. But the response to this debate shows that the government hasn't done a lot of listening and they're definitely not acting. People right across the country need and want an immediate emergency response at a scale we have not seen before. And, Presiding Officer, the long-term answer to this is simple. It will be ended by increasing in supply the number of houses across all tenures through building more homes. And in both Edinburgh and Argyll & Bute's declarations, they said that the lack of supply is the significant problem, so building more homes across all tenures is a key part of the solution. But it's SNP government in action, exacerbating the emergency, finding reasons not to act. It refuses to set the all-tenure house-building target that Homes for Scotland have called for, targets that could focus government and industry, coordinating action to tackle this crisis. And the Minister's amendment talks of working on the task and finish group recommendations, but it's his officials who are in charge telling him the government cannot commit to an interim social house building target. The government trumpets housing completions, but the number of social homes have dropped by 24% compared to last year. And its chances of picking up the pace are dire because the numbers of homes which have been approved has plummeted by 50%. The government has to double what they're doing now to have any chance of maintaining the number of homes it plans to build. And at the same time, the number of empty homes has jumped by 1,500 in the past year, but it still hasn't delivered an escalating council tax surcharge. And worse still, since it set its 110,000 target, the government has seen an exodus of staff from the very team tasked with delivering more homes. The Minister's own department have been sounding the alarm for months now, an open secret that there is a high risk that affordable housing targets could be missed altogether. And despite mortgage rates rocketing, we're almost 2 years. 2 years into a review into the Homeowner Support Fund, with still no new support for people struggling with their mortgage payments. Government inaction, time and time again, making this emergency worse. Strangling the pipeline, failing to deliver the homes we need, and look at the consequences. Given half the chance to accept there is a need to take drastic action, the government are looking the other way. The Finance Secretary said yesterday that the government is broke, but the truth is that with relentless cuts to council budgets, they're trying to tackle this crisis with one hand behind their backs. I've heard from constituents destitute in their own homes because they can or won't be rehomed. An amputee who can't get out of his building. The pensioner on the top floor with mobility needs, told that they're adequately housed, but left with little option than presenting as homeless. In East Lothian, we have heard, in the Minister's backyard, they've said that they cannot take any more homes because the revenue demands to run schools and services are too high. Now, Presiding Officer, the Edinburgh and Argyll and Bute have faced up to reality, but every part of this country is facing a housing emergency. Everyone can see it, everyone can feel it, apart from
you
those
need to conclude,
in St Andrew's
Mr.
House. It's time for the government to accept, to admit that there is a housing emergency in Scotland, and to support the motion which I move in my name.
Thank you, Mr. Griffin. Just a reminder to those that are looking to participate in the debate that haven't already done so to press the request to speak buttons, and I call Paul McLennan to speak to and move amendment 11351.2. Minister, up to 8 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome this afternoon's debate on housing. This government has three missions: equality, opportunity and community. Can I also thank stakeholders who have engaged with us today, who I meet on a regular basis. Housing is a building block for success in all three. To tackle poverty and protect people from harm, we must have secure and affordable homes. For people to share in economic opportunities, they need the stability of a home. And for communities to thrive and realise their full potential, people need a place to live in peace and in dignity. Housing is at the heart of our social, emotional and economic lives. I am committed to giving housing and homelessness the support and attention it deserves, and have been doing so since being in post, not at the moment, thanks. I've met many experts in the sector. I've spoken to tenants in the private and social rented sectors. I've heard moving personal stories from people with lived experience of homelessness. I've met with investors. What people tell me is that Scotland has the right housing targets, the right plan to end homelessness, but what they want is for me to do is to keep these plans moving forward, to maintain momentum with our targets, to create the right environment for investment. I'm proud of Scotland's record on housing, but we need to do much and want to do more. Now, I want to focus obviously on affordable delivery of affordable homes. Our ambition is for everyone, not at the moment, we've only got a limited time, thanks. Our ambition is for everyone to have a safe and affordable home that meets their needs. Yeah, well, I will. Let me make progress. This is why we're making £3.5 billion available in this parliamentary term towards the delivery of more affordable and social homes. Since 2007, we have worked with partners to deliver nearly 124,000 homes, over of which 87,000 of which were for social rent. Now, I want to touch on the point that Mark Griffin made. In this period, Scotland has seen 40%, not at the moment, thanks, has seen 40% more affordable homes delivered per head of population than England, and over 70% more than in Wales. Mark Griffin was asked about policy ideas by Kate Forbes. Not at the moment, thanks. And when I was asked about that, we've delivered more. Now, having a look at Labour's record, I've got the figures here. Between 1999 and 2007, there were 43,500 affordable homes delivered, an average of 5,500. Between 2007 and 2023, 122,205 houses were delivered, an average of 7,630, an average of 40% more per annum than in the period 1999 to 2007. So I would suggest that Mr Griffin checks his figures. These are official figures that have come through. But I'll give way to Mark Griffin.
Mark Griffin.
Social homes are clearly crucial. The figures I said were all 10-year house builds. Every single year of a Labour government, we built on average 5,000 more houses every single year. That shortfall set out by Homes for Scotland has resulted in the housing crisis and the chronic lack of supply that we have today.
Minister.
Government doesn't build private houses. We'll help the private sector do that, but we don't build private houses. Affordable homes, 40% more delivery by the Scottish Government now than the previous Labour administration. Fact. I've got to make progress, thanks. Back in 2016, we also brought an end to UK Government place a policy of right to buy, which took more than 500,000 homes out of the social rented sector in Scotland. And to my Tory colleagues, since ending the right to buy policy, we estimate that up to 15,500 homes have been protected and will remain available to renters. No thanks. Looking forward, we are committed to delivering our target of 110,000 affordable homes by 2032, of which at least 70% will be available for social rent and 10% will be in our rural and island communities. It's an ambitious target, but we are making progress. Since the 23rd of March 2022, 13,500 homes have been delivered towards the target, of which 10,500 are for social rent, including almost 23,000 council homes. We're taking concrete action to boost housing supply, but some matters are beyond our control, whether we like it or not. Inflationary pressures. I've been speaking to developers, 15 to 20% construction inflation. Our £752 million budget this year includes at least £60 million to support acquisitions. No, I'm not going to take an acquisition. No, no thanks. This will address high numbers of households and temporary accommodation. Our recently published Rural and Island Housing Action Plan supports our commitment to delivering at least 10% of our 110,000 target in rural and island communities. It marks an important step in tackling challenges to delivering more homes in rural and island areas. The plan includes a £25 million rural affordable housing plan for key workers over 5 years and a 3-year package of support worth almost £1 million, co-funded with Nationwide Foundation. This will go to Communities Housing Trust and South of Scotland Community Housing. I was up this morning visiting Rural Housing, a rural Stirling Housing Association, and talking about the difference that action plan is beginning to make already. So between 2016 and 2017, we have supported the delivery of more than 10,000 affordable homes in rural and highland areas. We also talk about the importance, obviously, of preventing homelessness. We've got a world-leading approach on this. We're proud of our record on affordable housing supply, but we must also mitigate against the factors that contribute to housing precarity and homelessness. We see housing as a human right, and that's why we're taking a world-leading approach to preventing and dealing with homelessness. No, I'll take on that point.
Stephen Kerr.
The reality is that the Minister has just given us a catalogue of complacency. Why are there record levels of homelessness in Scotland? Why on earth can he not see the connection between the rent freeze that this government imposed and the levels of rising levels of rent and the rising levels of homelessness?
Minister.
We will touch on this. Just today, and thankfully, just today, the Chancellor obviously talked about scrapping the freeze on local housing allowance. Now, the damage done over 3 years by your government, the damage done over these 3 years by your government is an estimated £819 million cut to the allowance across the UK, coupled with cuts of £181 million to Scotland's capital budget. So don't. In terms of that. So, as I said, we're seeing a continuing trend in repeat homelessness. A decrease in homelessness from the private renting sector and reports of rough sleeping remain lower than at pre-pandemic levels. But the housing and homelessness sectors are under great strain. The last year has seen particularly difficult for them, and this was reflected in our latest homelessness statistics. We know that councils are making huge efforts to deliver services for people experiencing homelessness. But recovery from the pandemic, a continuing cost of living crisis, and over a decade of austerity from your government, Mr Kerr, has put people, businesses,
chair,
public
please,
finances
Minister.
And the third sector under unprecedented pressures. This is why we have to focus on the things that matter, and that's reducing the backlog in temporary accommodation. We recognise the challenges facing local authorities, which is I've been going around the country meeting with housing conveners to see how national and local government can work together on solutions. We are acting on the recommendations of the Expert Temporary Accommodation Task and Finish Group, including investing in the National Acquisition Plan. That's £60 million that was announced in July. We continue to support local authorities and registered social landlords to make use of their existing stock, to bring empty homes back into use and increase allocations to homeless households. To support this activity, the Scottish Government has made an additional £2 million available to the 15 local authorities with the most significant temporary accommodation pressures. Now, in the longer term, we know the best way to reduce the numbers in temporary accommodation is to support people to stay in their homes and avoid the trauma of homelessness. We are introducing groundbreaking new homelessness prevention duties this parliamentary year, which are designed to improve the way local authorities and registered social landlords and public bodies cooperate to prevent homelessness. So, and we all know that certain groups are in a particular risk of homelessness, including women experiencing domestic abuse. We're piloting a £500,000 fund to help women leave an abusive relationship. We've also made £83 million available for discretionary housing payments this year. This money will be used to fully mitigate the UK Government's unfair bedroom tax, helping over 92,000 households in Scotland stay in their homes. We've also committed to mitigating the UK's benefit cap as fully as possible within the powers. That cap impacts over 2,700 families. Now, it'll be interesting to see what Labour's position is. If they take power next year, we'll be on these. And I would hope they would commit to that and hopefully hear that from Mr Griffin later on. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, many of the challenges facing Scotland's housing market today are born of disastrous decisions. The freezing of local housing allowance we've talked about, a hard Brexit and a catastrophic mini-budget last year. This Government has been working hard to secure the uplift of local housing allowance in advance of the UK Budget statement today. Now, I'm relieved to hear that the Chancellor will be scrapping the freeze on the local housing allowance.
You do need to conclude, Minister.
So, just to conclude, this Government recognises the challenges faced by people like this young woman. We know there is unmet housing need. People deserve better. We will continue to work in partnership with local authorities, with landlords and with housing developers to ensure we have the right range and choice of homes to allow our communities to thrive. I move amendment in my name. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. I now call on Graeme Simpson to speak to and move amendment 11351.1 up to 6 minutes. Mr Simpson.
Thank you very much. And can I start by thanking Labour for bringing this debate to the Chamber, and I move the amendment in my name. The starting point for this debate is whether you agree that there is a housing emergency, and it appears that the Scottish Government does not think there is. And this is despite overwhelming evidence and two councils declaring one in their own area, including the capital, backed by SNP councillors. The Government's amendment is petty, and it shows an administration that's out of touch with reality, and we won't support it. The evidence is compelling. The number of homeless applications has increased by 9% in 2022-23. 16,200 children were assessed or threatened with homelessness. Over 6,000 families have been stuck in temporary accommodation for more than a year. The longest amount of time a child's been stuck in temporary accommodation exceeds a year in most council areas. And of course, in Edinburgh City Council, as this month overwhelmingly declared the housing emergency in the capital, the second council to do so, along with Argyll and Bute. And Edinburgh Council's housing convener said, by declaring a housing emergency, we hope to draw wide-scale attention to an issue that demands urgent and united action. Every single person deserves a warm, safe and affordable place to call home, and we can address this if we act now. Shelter Scotland Director Alison Watson said of that declaration, Scotland is facing a housing emergency, which is at its most acute in the capital. That in itself should be enough for anyone to back the Labour motion. Not for the government, though. Yes, I will.
Kate Forbes.
I thank the member for taking an intervention. Of course, one of the challenges around housing is how widespread the difficulties are, not least, actually, for owners who are in a position of struggling to afford their mortgages because under a previous Tory leader, she crashed the economy, leaving people facing rocketing bills. What does he have to say to them?
Graeme Simpson.
Well, we need an all-tenure solution to the housing crisis, the housing emergency, which the government denies. Shelter laid out the statistics in stark terms. A record 9,500 children trapped in temporary accommodation. That's up 130% since 2014. 45 children becoming homeless every day, a household becoming homeless every 16 minutes, a 10% increase in households becoming homeless compared to last year. Now, Presiding Officer, homelessness is at its worst when we have people sleeping rough on the streets. And that's on the rise again. It's at its worst when we have people having to use night shelters. We must commit to ending both. During the last session, I was on the Local Government and Communities Committee, and we did an inquiry into homelessness. We visited Finland in October 2017 to look at that country's Housing First model. And there, they had virtually eliminated rough sleeping. We recommended that the Scottish Government adopted the same approach. For a time, it looked like they were on board, but now we seem to be slipping backwards. No one should have to sleep rough. No one should have to use a night shelter, but they do, and that's what makes it an emergency. So it's disappointing that the government does not see it that way. It has its head in the sand. You can't begin to tackle a problem unless you first acknowledge the scale of it. You only have to listen to people like the Edinburgh students who I met this morning who describe an emergency for them in this city. One of the big issues for many years, of course, has been our very low rates of house building. And the government amendment fails to recognise the need for more homes of all tenures or acknowledge that the delivery of private housing is also pivotal to delivering and unlocking affordable housing delivery. You didn't take my intervention, Mr. McLennan, so I won't take yours.
No, through the chair.
We know that the SNP government failed to meet its 50,000 affordable homes target on time in the last parliament. We also know that the number of affordable homes approved has reached its lowest level in 10 years. And social sector new build starts are 36% down on last year. The social housing sector needs to be a priority. And we should not forget the private rented sector, which has seen landlords bailing out and rents rising thanks to Patrick Harvey's ill-judged rent cap policy. Now, my amendment merely recognises that there is legislation on the way, and we simply suggest that it should be used as an opportunity to change things. And if anyone opposes the amendment, they will need to say what exactly the housing bill should be for if it is not to fix things. We've seen little in the way of detail so far about the bill, but it must tackle the issue I've raised, and it must do something to address the chronic undersupply. Presiding Officer, denying the problem won't fix the problem. Is there a housing emergency? You bet there's a housing emergency.
Thank you, Mr. Simpson. I now call Willie Rennie up to 6 minutes. Mr. Rennie.
I mean, SNP members, including Kate Forbes, of course are right when they talk about the Liz Truss budget from last year. It had a dramatic impact on household finances and meant that many people just simply couldn't afford their mortgage. And of course, construction costs have gone up in part because of Brexit, but also because of that budget as well. There's no doubt also that demographics have changed. The demand for housing is going up quite steeply. And even though more houses, to be fair, are getting built, it's not meeting that demand. And that's in part why we're seeing quite a dramatic impact on the housing situation in Scotland. We've also got the position of holiday homes, the short-term lets, which we've debated frequently, but also second homes, which is putting quite a bit of pressure on parts of the world like the East Nuke, where I represent. And of course, student demand has changed with more families being brought over with students from Africa in some parts of the country. So that all of that amounts to a really difficult situation, huge pressures that are applied. But I think it's just unacceptable, in the context of all that, to not acknowledge that we do have a housing emergency. We've got a really difficult situation. Yes, I'll take it.
John Swinney.
I'm grateful to Mr. Rennie for giving way. And before he leaves the circumstances and context in which we find ourselves, does he think that the prolonged austerity that was ushered in by the Liberal Democrats in 2010 has been a help or a hindrance in tackling the housing challenges that we face?
Willie Rennie.
Mr. Swinney knows, because he was a particularly astute curator of the finances that it was important to get the finances under control, but it's on the record that it was important to get the balance right between spend for the public purse and spend for the private citizen. Some mistakes, of course, were made during that period, but overall, I don't think Mr Swinney would deny that there were quite cataclysmic circumstances in which we found ourselves when we arrived in government. But we are here today, and we are here dealing with a housing emergency that has been part, and if Mr Swinney wishes to make this a partisan point, which I was seeking not to do, then I think it's important that we do recognise the failures of the Scottish Government in this regard, because they have not met the increasing and rising demand for housing. There's a couple in my constituency in their 60s that are sofa surfing. There is a disabled, numerous disabled families. Now, they're not interested now because we're talking about the difficulties that people are facing in their daily lives. But there are disabled people right across my constituency who are crammed into overcrowded housing, not enough space for their equipment. It is in very difficult circumstances for them. Their quality of life has plummeted. We've got damp, overcrowded houses, people surrounded by antisocial behaviour, disabled people living upstairs, which is completely unsuitable for their needs. We've got housing officers in Fife who are being increasingly blunt with my office, and they're saying there just are no homes left. Now, if that's not a housing emergency, I don't know what is. And of course, it's not all the SNP's fault. Of course, Liz Truss's budget is partly responsible. Of course, the demographic changes are responsible as well. But it doesn't negate the fact that we have an emergency, and we should acknowledge that rather than complacently going on thinking our plans are going to be enough. I'll take an intervention.
Minister.
Just to address a point that Mr Rennie's made, there have been calls today, I think, for Scotland to declare a housing emergency. Now, whatever we decide to call it, and the respective decisions of the local authorities have done that already, it's the actions that we take is the most important thing, and I think it's keen to stress that. And we do have a programme of action, and just for a bit in context, we build 40%,
Minister, it needs to be brief.
We build 40% more heads of population than housing than England and 70% more than Labour-controlled Wales.
Willie Rennie.
But it's clearly not enough. The people who are desperate for houses, don't listen to those statistics. They believe they've not got a home because they don't have a home. They read that statistic, they'll have no more comfort. Now, it may satisfy the housing minister, but it doesn't satisfy them. That's why we need to accept there's a housing emergency. Now, I think this motion's good, but it's an opposition motion. I actually think Cammy Day and Edinburgh City Council and the leadership over in Argyll and Bute deserve huge credit, because there's a bit of self-criticism involved in announcing a housing emergency in Edinburgh and Argyll and Bute, because they're partly responsible for the situation that we're in. Wouldn't it be a really powerful statement today if the minister was to accept that although he claims he's doing more, it's clearly not enough and we have an emergency? Because that would bring some comfort to my constituents who are desperate for a home. They would get some comfort from a minister who acknowledges that more is required to be done. For those, 4,735 households that have got children in them that are in temporary accommodation. The 29,600 homeless houses in the system. We've got 693,000 people in some kind of housing need. That's an emergency. And especially when the news starts now, I understand the construction costs have gone up, which is making it difficult for house builders to build more. But they're down. The news starts are down 26% when the demand is shooting right up. So we need to do so much more, and we need to accept that we've got an emergency. That's what I'm hoping to hear from the minister today, because I think he wants to sort this problem, but he won't sort it if he denies the reality.
Thank you. We now move to the open debate. I call first Sarah Boyack, to be followed by Kevin Stewart. Up to 6 minutes, Ms Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to draw members' attention to my register of interest with my former employment. Edinburgh's housing shortage has been getting worse for years, and on the 2nd of November, as colleagues have acknowledged, the City of Edinburgh Council unanimously declared a housing emergency, recognising that we're in the depths of a housing crisis that is touching all aspects of society. It's one of the key issues where people ask me for help as a representative. I have families from all backgrounds contacting me about the perilous situation they find themselves in. We urgently need action investment because at the moment we're not getting them the homes they urgently need. As of the 30th of October this year, nearly 5,000 families are being housed in temporary accommodation, up from 3,500 in March 2020, and that is only expected to rise as our population continues to grow. And despite Edinburgh being our capital, as has been acknowledged, we have the lowest proportion of social affordable rented homes compared to the rest of the country, only 16% as opposed to the national average of 24%. So it's no surprise that people are struggling to find somewhere safe and affordable to live. And a recent council report highlighted that for every available house, there are on average 197 bids for every single available house. And that means that time after time, families are refused suitable housing because there simply are not enough homes available. And the picture in the private rented sector is just as bad. We've lost homes to the short-term let sector, and Edinburgh has the highest private rented costs in Scotland, with average rentals in excess of £1,400 a month, more than £400 more than the Scottish average. That is only due to rise, and that's despite the rent freeze and the eviction ban passed. But it's not just the financial burden. No, I want to crack on. It's also the missed economic opportunities to create jobs in our local communities and the supply chains. It's a massive human impact. The warm, safe, affordable accommodation is bedrock that everybody needs for their lives. And the knock-on impact of not having somewhere safe and affordable to live is massive. Evidence by crisis suggests that on average 45% of people who are homeless suffer from poor mental health, and that rises to 8 in 10 people who are rough sleeping. So when someone's health begins to deteriorate, their mental health within 72 hours of becoming homeless, it just illustrates how we need everyone to have access to that home. And we know the impact of being homeless on a child can be catastrophic on their academic as well as their emotional well-being and their opportunities in life. So with an estimated 9,000 children in temporary accommodation across Edinburgh, 9,000 children, that's just Edinburgh alone where those children are being let down because of the failure to deal with this housing emergency. And think of being one of those kids' parents, the huge pressure they're under. So we must do better, and we must give every one of those children and families the opportunity to learn and develop and have a safe home. And this crisis goes way further than the numbers suggest. Students have been mentioned in the Chamber today. That doesn't include the 14% of students who have experienced homelessness in Edinburgh this year at some point in their studies. We now have 100,000 students in Edinburgh. That is a significant number of young people who are either forced to sofa surf or commute from further afield, both of which scenarios are going to have a detrimental impact on their ability to learn. So if we're going to solve this issue, we urgently need to act. Local authorities need additional support and resources if we're going to make the difference we need. We need to bring more empty homes. Yes, I will on that particular
Minister.
Point.
Yeah. And I'll try and be brief, Presiding Officer. A couple of things. She knows that the member knows that I meet with the Edinburgh Council on a regular basis. £60 million acquisition was announced during the summer. And Edinburgh are working with that just now. But does she acknowledge the partnership work and it's required also? Edinburgh acknowledged it needs to do more around about the 1,500 empty homes it has. We're working very closely with Edinburgh on that and on their allocations policy. It's not just about funding.
The challenge isn't people being willing to work together, whether it's the voluntary sector, the councils, or even talking to the minister. It's the finance. Because yes, a small amount of money to bring some empty homes back into use is good, but local authorities need more resources so that we tackle this properly. We have now had several roundtables. The minister knows that in Edinburgh alone, with MSPs, tenants, students, universities, the council, and key stakeholders coming together. But we need more than warm words. We need action now. I've met people in the streets. I've heard their personal stories about how they ended up homeless and the massive personal cost to them and their families. So preventing homelessness in the first place is critical. Our housing charities do an amazing job, but there are queues around the buildings where people get support. There are women who've ended up rough sleeping after domestic violence, and there are families living in rooms with bed bugs and nowhere to cook food. We have a systemic crisis. This Parliament needs to come together and admit that and move to act, because it's not the equality, opportunity and community that the Minister said he'd like to see. Edinburgh saw a crisis, they saw that it was facing this crisis, and they came across the parties to declare a housing emergency. We're going to hear that across Scotland, colleagues have seen significant pressures on families in their constituency. So Scotland is facing a housing emergency. So we need to act. We need to take Edinburgh's lead, look at the crisis we're facing, and start to invest, support our councils, our housing providers, end the thousands of empty homes that lie vacant for far too long. We need the Scottish Government to do the heavy lifting, because without leadership, our constituents are being let down, and that is not acceptable. Thank you.
I now call Kevin Stewart to be followed by Pam Gosal. Up to 6 minutes, Mr Stewart.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And housing plays a fundamental part in all of our lives. And I've said this before, and I'll probably say it again, that we must rise to the challenges that the future brings, whether that be recovering from the pandemic, tackling climate change and achieving net zero, and supporting our ageing population. We know that ensuring every one of us has a home that meets our needs will be crucial. This means that we need to have homes which are accessible and affordable, warm and sustainable, with a thriving community near the services that people rely on. Affordable housing can help reduce poverty and inequality as people spend less of their income on housing costs and other essentials in life. And that's why we have kept poverty levels down in Scotland, because rents have been cheaper here. Also, living in a warm and affordable home helps health outcomes and also improves educational attainment. And, of course, in a warm, affordable home, we also feel more grounded in our communities. For individuals, for families that face homelessness, that's an emergency for them. That is a crisis for them. That is a reality. But we have had a lot of discussion today around about action and inaction. And some folk seem more than happy to forgive and forget some actions. Let's look at that in some depth. Because one of the problems that we have, I'll give way to Mr. Johnson.
Daniel Johnson.
I'm very grateful to the member for giving me. He's just described as those circumstances being an emergency for those individuals. Why is it so difficult then to describe the situation for everyone facing those circumstances as being an emergency?
I think that for each of those individuals, for all of those folks who are currently sofa surfing or are homeless, that is a crisis for them. And that is what we need to do. What we need to do is to make sure that we and get more houses in place to stop that kind of situation. But also, a lot of folk are in crisis at this moment because of the cost of living, which nobody seems to be willing to talk about today, brought on by the trust budget, which means that many folk who are now facing homelessness, who never ever thought they would face that, are doing so because they can no longer pay their mortgages because of high interest rates. They cannot pay their energy bills. They cannot cope with food prices going up. But that is something that many of us here today seem unwilling to talk about because it doesn't fit the agenda. I'll give way to Mr. Rennie.
Willie Rennie.
In fact, I'm sure he was listening because I did talk about that. But surely this Parliament should really be focusing on what we can do. Of course, we can send a message to Westminster, but what we should do should be our priority for today. Is he going to spend more time on that today?
Kevin Stewart.
Spend more time on that. And credit to Mr. Rennie, because he did talk about these issues, presiding officers. Others did not. Let's look at action, because the minister will be sitting at the front there, as I've done previously as a housing minister, and he will want to do as much as he possibly can. But the reality is that the minister is bounded by the amount of finance that's available. And since I've been in this Parliament, since 2011, what we have seen is constant capital cuts from the UK government, which of course restricts the housing minister and other ministers who want to spend on capital projects. Let's look at what the government has done, and let's look at what the government plans to do. Because if we look at the parliamentary term where I was Housing Minister, 2016 to 21, the ambition was to build 50,000 affordable homes during the course of that parliament. And we would have done so if it hadn't been for COVID. The target itself was reached a year later in March 2022. 50,000 affordable homes was an immense target. I wanted to go further and faster. The government wanted to go further and faster. But unfortunately, the money is available to the government, to Mr. Swinney and finance secretaries, was not there because Westminster kept cutting capital budgets. That's the reality. But even with that, we still have managed to build more affordable homes per head of population since 2007-08 than any other part of the UK. 13.9 homes per 10,000 population here in Scotland, 9.7 in England, 8 in Wales, 13 in Northern Ireland. Now, I'm sure that the Minister, sitting at the front, would want to go much, much further than that, because I certainly would want to see that happen too. But he is bounded by that finance. I think we also need to look at the reality of some of the things that have been said, the truth, because there was talk of inaction from the Labour benches and a lack of reality in terms of what they did. Inaction there has been. There was inaction during the Labour-Liberal years in terms of stopping the sale of council homes, which we did to help people, and they delivered much less affordable housing over the course of their tenure every year than this government has done. And also, they have the shameful record of only managing to build six council homes
in
their
last
years in power. Presiding Officer...
You need to conclude.
I will conclude, Presiding Officer. The Housing to 2040 visions and principles were shaped through extensive consultation. We need to move in that front. Hopefully the Minister will get more finance. Certainly it hasn't come from the Chancellor today, because like everyone in this chamber, I think he and I want to go further.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. OK, Pam Gosal, to be followed by Ben McPherson. Up to 6 minutes, Ms. Gosal.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am pleased to be able to contribute to this debate about how we address Scotland's housing emergency. And I would also like to thank Labour for bringing such an important debate to the Chamber today. And I will be supporting both the Labour motion and the amendment in the name of my colleague, Graeme Simpson. Housing is everybody's business. Our problem with the housing system is the responsibility of all of us to fix. But as we have heard already this afternoon, the evidence that Scotland is facing a housing emergency is absolutely clear. Earlier this year, Argyll and Bute Council in my region declared their own housing emergency. And in recent meetings with several local authority chief execs, they were clear that housing supply was one of the biggest challenges, particularly due to the increasing number of homeless applications they're having to deal with. Nobody in this day and age should be at risk of homelessness. But this is still something which thousands of people in Scotland are facing each year. There are currently 30,000 households in Scotland's homeless system, which is the highest level since records began. I've just begun. I'd take one maybe later on. There has also been a 10% increase in the number of households becoming homeless in the last year alone. And as we have heard already today, there are also nearly 10,000 children currently in temporary accommodation, which is an increase of 130% since 2014. This is an emergency that has been developing for a long time. We know that the Scottish Government failed to meet their previous target of building 50,000 affordable homes by 2021. Then in 2021, the Scottish Government set a target building 110,000 affordable homes by 2032. But so far, progress towards the target has been mixed at its best. The number of affordable homes approved has now reached the lowest level for 10 years. And in the most recent quarter, social sector home starts have fallen by 36% compared to the previous year.
Minister, briefly.
Yeah, speaking to local authorities and speaking to registered social landlords, the biggest barrier at the moment is the cost of borrowing. and it's high interest rates, construction inflation, which has been around about 15 to 20%. So the UK government has to take its blame on that. It's the high cost of borrowing which is delaying that.
Pam Gosol.
I thank the member for that intervention. It's actually a global problem, but also I want to say that I have been just last week speaking to chief execs, and they've made it very clear that the Scottish Government is failing them. The onus lies right here in the Parliament with the Scottish Government. So I think it would be good to actually listen to the rest, to listen to the rest of my speech, and you will see how we can all work together. On this issue, the Scottish Federation of Housing Associations has said this strain on the supply of new affordable homes is coming at a time when the need for social homes is only becoming more acute. The SNP may be holding out hope that the introduction of additional council tax premiums for second homes will increase availability on homes for local residents, but the evidence on this is not so clear. And a survey carried out by Property Mark found that most property agents did not believe that the policy would increase the sale of second homes. Property Mark also made clear that simply delivering more new homes would be a far more effective solution to housing shortages. And on top of this, there has been missed opportunities within the planning system too. When MPF4 was debated earlier this year, these benches were clear that the new planning framework failed to put Scotland's housing emergency front and centre of the planning system. Homes for Scotland have highlighted that NPF4 fails to deliver a workable plan for how a consistent pipeline of land for new housing can be provided in the long term. They also highlighted that NPF4 did not address the shortage of resources within the planning departments, which are causing huge delays for planning applications from home builders. Presiding officer, while there are clearly problems with the supply of housing, our amendment highlights the opportunity that lies in the forthcoming housing bill. As members have set out today, there are many problems with Scotland's housing sector, to which there are several possible solutions. Legislation is one such possible solution. As a member of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee, I look forward to the introduction of this bill next year, and I stand ready to take evidence from key stakeholders and scrutinise the bill constructively. And I'm hoping that the bill can deliver the changes that the housing sector needs, and the onus now lies upon the SNP Government to ensure this bill delivers on this potential. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, Scotland is facing a housing emergency. Today's debate is an opportunity for the Scottish Government to accept this. By accepting today's motion and our amendment, the SNP could send a clear signal that they are treating this issue with the seriousness it deserves. But the onus will still lie with the Scottish Government to act now. This action needs to include empowering our council to fulfil their obligations to prevent homelessness, ensuring councils have both the framework and resources they need to deliver new homes in every part of Scotland, and revising the current slowdown in the supply of new housing. By taking steps such as this, this government will be able to prevent this housing emergency from truly becoming a crisis.
Thank you, Ms Gosol. I need to reinforce the fact we have no time on hand, so it is up to 6 minutes. And can I also encourage the front benches to stop carrying on discussions while somebody's on their feet speaking? Ben McPherson, to be followed by Rhoda Grant, up to 6 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This issue, housing, is the most serious issue in my constituency and arguably for my generation and those younger. And it is for them that I speak today. Presiding Officer, it is true and widely recognised that there is a housing crisis in the UK, including in parts of Scotland, which includes Edinburgh, Northern and Leith, my constituency. But what is equally true is that this crisis is decades in the making. Context matters. It started way before devolution. It is true that the right to buy created problems that we are still dealing with today. It is true that in a time of plenty and buoyant public finances, the new Labour government could and should have done more. It is true that the coalition government of the Liberal Democrats and Conservatives' austerity agenda did impact on the housing challenges that we face in the here and now. And it is true that the public finance challenge that we face at the moment does constrain what we can action in this very serious situation. The crisis across the UK is wide-reaching. It's about quantity, quality and price. It is complex, it is monetary, it is fiscal, and it is all of our responsibility. And looking at that challenge in 2007, the Scottish Government rightly, the SNP Scottish Government rightly, committed to a significant affordable house building agenda, an investment in our shared national infrastructure. That has culminated again in the context of a period of a recession, an austerity agenda, a Brexit that Scotland didn't vote for, a pandemic, a situation of global conflict that impacted prices in terms of materials, and then also a disastrous Conservative Trust government that plunged the public finances into turmoil. In all of that context, the SNP government built around 124,000 new affordable homes, including the Leith Fort in my constituency and ongoing works in Granton. It ended the right to buy so that we are constantly topping up the quantum of affordable housing in Scotland, which is why our figures are so much higher than other parts of the UK, including in Labour-run Wales. But we need more, and that is true, and that is what we're focused on today. And that is why it is excellent that the Scottish Government is committed and focused, despite the challenge of the financial scenario that we're in, to building 110 affordable homes, at least 70% for social rent. So, in that context, we are in a shared position of greater success in Scotland, but a need to do more. And we need to recognise in those circumstances that parts of Scotland are facing a different challenge. Edinburgh is in a housing emergency, but there are also figures and there is evidence that our records on tackling poverty are better, particularly in other parts of Scotland, because of the investment that the Scottish Government has made in affordable housing. So I welcome this shared time today to discuss the collective challenge of what is happening in Scotland. But as Edinburgh, Northern and Leith's MSP, I'm sure you would expect me to focus on the emergency that we have in Edinburgh, because we do need specific attention to areas that have the highest level of challenge. In Edinburgh, we do have one of the lowest proportions of social housing in Scotland, and we have experienced one of the highest rates of population growth in recent years. That is reflected in my casework week after week. The challenge that that creates is growing higher and higher. Figures supplied by Shelter show there are over 6,000 live homeless applications, or there were on the 31st of March 2023. That's a 17% increase compared with the date a year before. Those are on Scottish Government figures. Briefly, yes.
Very briefly.
I wouldn't disagree with the historical analysis, but there is a crisis right across Scotland. Do you agree we need to tackle planning, we need to give local authorities far greater powers in order to be able to get the land, and we need to have a skills revolution?
Ms McPherson,
I'll come to some of those points briefly in a moment, but I would just say,
you must still conclude.
So in conclusion, Edinburgh has specific challenges that need specific attention. I do think the government needs to look at the Strategic Housing Investment Plan and the Affordable Housing Supply Programme on how it can target and focus on areas with the greatest need, And as has been mentioned by the other member, we have an opportunity in the Land Reform Bill coming to think about urban land reform and how we reduce the price of land for housing so that local authorities can compete when the private sector is trying to get that land because the demand is so high. So this is a really high priority, and it's right that Parliament's focus is on it, and particularly the Government's focus should be on Edinburgh, and I welcome the collaboration from the Government with me on that.
Thank you, Ms McPherson. I now call Rhoda Grant to be followed by John Swinney. Ms Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I want to draw members' attention to my register of interest in that I own a sixth share in a family home. Presiding Officer, there is a housing crisis in Scotland, and many members have discussed that this afternoon, but that crisis is much more pronounced in rural areas of Scotland. And sadly, the government doesn't seem to recognise the scale of the crisis given their amendment this afternoon. And that's really concerning, because if you don't recognise the scale of the crisis, how on earth are you going to rise to the challenge to meet that crisis and put it right? In rural Scotland, a lot of the problem is caused by second homes and holiday lets, and that inflates prices of homes. And that is due to people who live in those areas not being able to have the same finance or indeed ability to get a mortgage as those coming in. So, very
quick. Jim Fairley.
I'll be very brief. Would the member recognise and welcome the Scottish Government's position where it will introduce the ability for local authorities to charge far more on council tax for second homes?
Rhoda Grant.
And that has long been our policy, to make sure that that happens. But we have to go further, because people who can actually afford to buy a second home have a fair amount of free cash that allows them to pay that. So we have to look at other ways as well as that, recognising that they have a lot more money than local people. Local people can't get a mortgage because they often work in seasonal jobs. They've also got unstable jobs, and therefore banks demand a monthly salary, a stable income, and that's what they lend against. And people working three or four different jobs simply can't provide that to get a mortgage. Also, we need to take into account that the cost of living in rural areas is much higher. In good times, that was 30% higher. It'll be much more than that now. So that even means that they are less able to compete for homes in their communities. We look at the cost of building in rural communities as well, and it is hugely different. I continue to quote the unit price for a house in Barra, a socially rented house, and that was £233,000 for one unit. The government grant to housing associations for building in those areas is less than half of that, at £111,000. I've already given way, and I want to make progress, if I may. So not only do you have not enough grant coming from the government, you also have the higher cost of materials. A house costs 25% more before you even start to build it, due to the cost of transporting materials on ferries alone. Housing associations are also bound to tender their projects. And that means that the only people that can really afford to tender for that are large companies. Those large companies don't employ people on island or in rural communities. And that also adds to the cost, because they're bringing in workers from outside, and any economic benefit that could have been given to the rural community disappears, because all the profit to building that unit goes out. So we have to look at how we rural-proof our policies, because planning is very much urbanised. Now, I think many people have welcomed that the government have committed to 10% of their affordable homes being in rural and island areas, but I just want to pick that apart a little, because 17% of people in Scotland live in those same rural areas as defined by the Scottish Government. But this definition also includes small remote towns and accessible rural as well as remote rural. Now, the problem with that is you have got communities like Barra competing for this 10% with the leafy suburbs of Edinburgh. And that can't be right, because what will happen is most of that building will happen in the central belt.
Minister?
I acknowledge the 10%, I think, in the recent debate we had, talked about a minimum. In terms of competing with rural Edinburgh, I don't see that in the Rural Housing Action Plan that comes forward. This is for, you know, rural housing. It doesn't compete with Edinburgh. Happy to take it up with the member after that, but it doesn't compete with parts of Edinburgh in terms of funding.
Rosa Grant?
In Edinburgh, I'm talking about the leafy suburbs surrounding Edinburgh. And if you look at the Scottish Government's own map and own definition, those areas are what is... And if they're working to a different map, then I would very much want to see it. But certainly in the maps that they publish, that is not the point. It is competing with country towns and suburbs around the central belt and other cities as well. So we need to look at that to make sure that housing happens in our remote rural communities, because the cost is so much greater that if they're competing with those areas, they will not get any of the housing they need. There are many more issues I could speak about, because there are many issues affecting our areas. Companies are being encouraged to create their own housing to fulfil their skills shortage. But we in rural communities had moved away from tied housing. And I don't want to see a policy that drives us back to tied housing, where someone's roof over their head is dependent on their job and they're basically almost enslaved to a company because of that. Presiding officer, in conclusion, the whole of Scotland is in a housing crisis, but that is worse for the reasons I outlined in rural communities. And if the Scottish Government don't deal with that, they will be presiding over a turbocharged depopulation of our remote rural communities.
Thank you, Ms Grant. And I would remind members that there is no time in hand and the speeches are of up to 6 minutes. And with that, I call John Swinney to be followed by Douglas Thompson.
President Officer, it's a fundamental right and absolute necessity that people in our society should be appropriately housed. Safe and secure housing is essential to ensure individuals are able to participate fully and effectively in our society, with a stable base, and the individuals are able to provide a good quality environment in which children can be brought up. It's clear there are significant pressures on the supply of housing in various, perhaps all, parts of Scotland. My constituency in Perthshire North, there are acute challenges in the availability of housing to meet the needs of individuals and families, and I deal with the same types of cases that members have recounted in the debate today. Those pressures are present in most areas of the constituency, with the need to ensure that suitable and appropriate accommodation to meet the needs of individuals and families is available for all. But those pressures are perhaps at their most acute in areas where there is buoyant demand for tourism accommodation and where there is an attraction for people to own second homes. The affordability of housing is a real challenge for many people who seek to live and work in those communities, and the competition to obtain appropriate housing is intense. The implications do not stop there. There are significant consequences for private and public sector employers who face enormous challenges in recruiting staff, quite simply due to the inability of individuals to be able to afford to live in specific parts of my constituency. Of
course. Daniel Johnson.
I'm very grateful to the member for giving way. And I think it's interesting that he says perhaps these issues face the whole of Scotland, and I think highlights some particular issues here. Why then is there a reservation to describe this as an emergency? Would that not help clarify focus and attention?
Johnson.
I'll come on to address that point later in my speech. Over the course of the last 8 years, major developments have taken place in different parts of my constituency as a consequence of partnership funding from the Scottish Government and the local authority. Developments of 65 homes at the Glebe School site in Scoon, 12 homes in Ardler Road and Meagle, 20 houses at Lynn Road in Stanley, 20 flats in Birch Avenue in Scoon, 11 new homes in Springbank Road in Aylith, and 10 new homes in Balbeggie, with other developments where private developers have met their affordable housing targets. Now, while these developments are welcome, I recognise that they are not enough. That's why I welcome the good work that is being undertaken by organisations such as Aberfeldy Development Trust, who are taking forward key projects to boost affordable housing supply in communities where there is intense pressure on housing stock. Enabling organisations like the Aberfeldy Development Trust to play a part in this effort to improve housing supply is crucial. Now, although there are major challenges in housing supply, I'm proud of what the Scottish Government has achieved since it was elected in 2007. Before we came to power, and the Minister has made this point, our predecessors completed on average 5,431 affordable homes each year. Yeah. On average, since this Government came to power, 7,638 yeah. affordable homes were completed. Yeah. 5,431 each year under the Labour and Lib Dem administration, 7,638 affordable homes each year completed on average under the SNP. Those figures are undeniable. Now, the Labour and Lib Dem record was delivered during a period of burgeoning public finances. There was so much money around that the government at that time was unable to spend all the money that was available to it, and thankfully left £1.6 billion unspent when this government came to office in 2007. The record of the SNP government has been achieved in the aftermath of the financial crash in 2008. All of it has been achieved against a backdrop of austerity. All of it has been achieved against the backdrop of Brexit and the loss of staff. All of this has been achieved as the costs of borrowing have rocketed due to the Liz Truss quasi-quartang mini-budget disaster. So while there has been criticism of the government today, a significant amount has been done to tackle this issue. Now, various members have said, and this is where I come to Mr Johnson's point, that we should declare a housing emergency. I understand that aspiration. I understand the seriousness of the point. My colleague, Mr McPherson, just made a compelling speech about the importance of the situation, severity of the situation facing his constituents. But I respectfully say to Parliament, it's not enough just to do that. There must be substantial action set out about how we address that issue. And that was lacking in Mr Griffin's speech. He knows how much I respect his contributions to Parliament. We cannot just wish away the conditions that we face. Today, construction costs are higher. Borrowing costs are higher. The labour market is tight because of Brexit and the implications of Brexit. If we want to build more houses, we must be prepared to address the reality of the situation we face. If we want to allocate more money to the task of building more houses, members of Parliament must be honest enough to say what capital projects are not going to go ahead. What are we going to stop doing to create the space for more money to be spent on housing? Because I spent long enough in here as the Finance Minister, 9 years on a trot, and then 1 year of temporary cover from my dear friend Kate Forbes, listening to members of Parliament spending money twice. And it's getting particularly acute over here on the Conservative benches of spending money twice, three times, four times over. If we want to declare a housing emergency, we've got to be prepared to put our money where our mouth is. And that's a responsibility on every single member of Parliament.
Thank you, Mr Swinney. I now call Douglas Lumsden to be followed by Kate Forbes. Mr Lumsden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I refer members to my register of interest that shows I was a councillor at the start of this session. Thank you to Labour for bringing this important debate, and I would also like to thank the organisations who have sent briefings for today's debate and all those constituents who have emailed me in asking me to support this motion. So this is obviously a topic that affects so many people, and we will be supporting it today. Scotland is indeed facing a housing crisis, wholly due to this coalition of chaos from this devolved government of Greens and the SNP. They have imposed ridiculous measures on what was a thriving sector that have limited its ability for growth, while at the same time cut local government to the bone, preventing investment in affordable housing. And let us be clear, Presiding Officer, we're not talking about housing, we're talking about homes. Not at this point. These are places where people can find safety, security, warmth and comfort. A place where families can make a place for themselves and communities can be built. When the government gets this wrong, everything else flows from that. When people have no sense of place and of community, they have no sense of security. Homelessness is a scourge on our country and a sad indictment of this government, who are so focused on independence that they have lost sight of what the Scottish people want. The Scottish people want a government who are focused on their priorities, not the constitutional wranglings. They want a government who addresses the big issues in our society around housing, health, education and economic growth. and a government that invests in our communities. I will take the intervention.
Minister.
Does he acknowledge then that the biggest drivers of homelessness are poverty and inequality? At the moment, we are spending £83 million a year in discretionary housing payment. We also mitigate the unfair bedroom tax and the benefit cap. Surely if these were removed, that would benefit Scotland and have more money to spend on the issues that he's talking about.
Dr. Slumson.
Thank the Minister for his pre-scripted intervention here. No word of the national insurance cut by 2%. And what about the UK government paying a large proportion of everyone's energy bills last year? So we've seen a catalogue of failure in some of the statistics surrounding this issue. The number of homeless applications up by 9% in the last year. 16,263 children assessed or threatened with homelessness in the last year. 6,000 families in temporary accommodation. The number of affordable homes approved at its lowest level for 10 years, and the government's own targets of affordable homes missed. But unfortunately, we cannot say that this is incompetence on behalf of the Green SNP government. It is actually willful policymaking that is stifling growth and causing massive rent rises in our rented sector. The crazy rent cap policy brought in by the Greens in coalition with the SNP has brought massive rent rises in our cities, in particular with rent growth in Edinburgh outstripping that of London. Zoopla has said that landlords are left with no choice but to increase rents between tenancies to ensure that they are covering their costs. The number of homes that were in the rented sector being sold by landlords is also at its highest level since 2009, with many simply leaving the sector as it is no longer viable for them to continue, resulting in a loss of rental accommodation throughout Scotland. But the social rented sector has often been badly affected by the short-sightedness and willful neglect of this government. Councils are struggling to balance their budgets in the face of SNP austerity. When I was co-leader of Aberdeen City Council, I was proud that I worked with Labour to announce the largest social house building programme in the city for a generation. Not just 2,000 homes, but 2,000 gold standard quality homes. I didn't want poor quality homes thrown up quickly. I wanted social homes matching the standard and exceeding the private sector. Because, Presiding Officer, we have to be honest, many of our social rented homes are not up to the standard they should be. So we need to be building more homes to cope with the need, but also to replace much of the stock that we have. The Conservatives would give local authorities the ability to build more homes for the people of Scotland. We have pledged to introduce a Scottish Housing Delivery Agency, which will be entirely focused on the supply of new homes for our residents. We would relax planning laws so that more properties in our town centres could be brought into residential use for hard-working families. We would reverse the crazy rent freeze that has such a detrimental impact on our cities like Edinburgh. It's clear that it is a policy that was maybe introduced with good intentions, but has made the issue worse. We need to do more to create homes and communities in our cities, towns and villages right across Scotland. We need to invest in housing so that families can find the security they need to build their lives in a safe and secure setting. We need certainty for house builders that we are a country committed to economic growth, and we need funding for local councils to build more affordable homes in our communities. We need a planning system that has flexibility to bring disused properties into commercial use, and we need a government that is focused on the people of Scotland and not independence. This government has taken its eye off the ball when it comes to housing in Scotland, and they need to do better for all our communities. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Lumsden. I now call Kate Forbes, be followed by Ariane Bridges. Ms. Forbes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Well, I want to start by saying that I certainly understand the sentiment behind the Labour motion today. I think anyone who saw some of the news coverage after Edinburgh Council declared its housing emergency would have been struck by the powerful stories told by those who are in temporary accommodation. And as Willie Rennie, I think, quite rightly said, that for those who are caught in temporary accommodation or at risk of homelessness or struggling in other ways to access warm housing, it does feel like an emergency. But I do think that John Swinney's point is the point that I was going to make, because real leadership isn't just about accepting the scale of a challenge or explaining what is taking place. Real leadership is about stepping back and figuring out how to best solve it and then getting stuck in to delivering on some of those solutions. And so there's no dispute from me about the scale of the challenge. And Rhoda Grant talked about the issues in rural Scotland, which I'm particularly well aware of. I mean, time and time again, my constituency office reflects on the fact that housing tops our caseload of issues that are of concern to local individuals. And yet, every Friday and Monday in the constituency, I have a never-ending list of new housing developments to visit in the Highlands, because there is obvious evidence of the government's funding going in to building houses and increasing supply. And that's why I asked Mark Griffin about Labour's solution. Because actually, based on my years as a finance minister and based on as a local MSP, there feels like there has never been greater investment in improving the supply of housing of all tenures. The question there is, why is there still a sense, in the Highlands particularly, of individuals, whether they are looking to access so-called affordable housing or looking to get on the housing market themselves, why is it so challenging? And I've got one solution that I want to come on to. But first of all, I want to illustrate a little bit more of the problem. Because quite clearly, the challenges around accessing housing is inhibiting economic growth, it is undermining some of our public services, and it is creating greater levels of homelessness in some of our communities, inhibiting economic growth. Fort William, great opportunities there for businesses to grow and develop. Between the sawmill, the smelter, other businesses, we have the decommissioning in Kishorne. It has a sense of great prosperity and being on the cusp of something incredible in a place like Fort William. But every business tells me the biggest challenge is not their ambition or actually the opportunity, it's accessing staff. And that is linked to housing. Public services and Sky, it's well documented, the challenges of accessing housing for some of our key workers, whether those are nurses, doctors or teachers, which means that key vacancies can't be filled. And then when it comes to homelessness, I was speaking to one of our social landlords who was clear that we need to make sure that homelessness policies are rural proofed, because how you might prevent it in urban areas may actually exacerbate it in rural areas. And then we have a place like Aviemore, where again lots of young workers find themselves having to live in Inverness and travelling an hour to get to Aviemore, because there may be a plentiful supply of, for example, one bedroom housing, but as soon as they find a partner, start a family, they're unable to stay. So that's the scale of it. I understand it. I recognise it. But what I think the solution is here is, yes, continuing to improve supply. There's no question about that. But I think we need to see greater flexibility around policies. And I want to give you five quick policies where I want to see greater flexibility. One is on policies. Because if we continue to have an overly fixed or rigid solution to this problem, we're going to run into the challenge that one size doesn't fit all. The solution in the middle of Edinburgh, which might be of huge interest to Ben McPherson, will not work in Elgol, in Skye. So we have to be clear that policies are flexible. Secondly, it has to be community-led. In Glenelg at the moment, the community are trying to build new housing. And it needs to be community-led. And where they find that the policy doesn't lend itself to what they're trying to do, I don't think it's that they should change. I think it's the policy should change. Thirdly, I think we need to listen to those that are actually out there delivering. The Communities Housing Trust, for example, second to none, exemplary, brilliant in what they do. They say, without quoting them, that largely all the policies and the funding, in their humble opinion, is there. But actually, it's about using that policy and ensuring that we can deliver solutions in each of these areas. Fourthly, is planning. Why does it take between 7 to 10 years to get 6 houses built? That does not add up. It doesn't make sense. And I think there needs to be some sort of default.
Ms Forbes has got about 2 seconds
default
left.
Default in favour of planning. And last and most important is land reform. We need to see more progress in making land available. And on that, I will close. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Forbes. And I now call Ariane Burgess to be followed by Jim Fairley. Ms Burgess.
Presiding officer, we're living through the worst cost crisis for generations with high inflation and a squeeze on household budgets, which is why I welcome this opportunity to discuss the housing challenges Scotland faces. One of the biggest expenses people have is housing, which is why the first piece of legislation brought through the Parliament by a Green minister provided immediate support to tenants by capping rents. Last year, more than 10,000 homes were completed under the Affordable Housing Supply Programme, roughly the equivalent to the total housing stock of Orkney or Shetland, and a 12% increase on the year before. Over the course of this parliamentary term, we will be introducing the biggest expansion of tenants' rights since devolution, including better rights and protections and better rent controls. The causes and solutions to the housing crisis in the Highlands and Islands, which I represent, are complex. A lack of supply, an ageing population, high land values, an imbalance between local wages and house prices, and poor public transport all play a part. As my colleagues will know, I'm a champion of community-led housing, and it was good to hear Kate Forbes talking about that just now, and the potential of this model to transform housing, particularly in rural communities. And that's why Greens in government secured stable funding for the rural housing enablers who empower communities to build the right homes in the right places. And that's why we're working to deliver the Rural and Island Housing Action Plan to ensure access to genuinely affordable homes. And that's why rural councils have rightly welcomed plans to increase council tax for empty and second homes. And we must continue to work closely with all councils to develop targeted plans to address local housing needs. Homelessness in rural areas isn't just a lack of a roof over someone's head. It is also the loss of community, of young people of working age, a loss of language and culture. And we need more homes. We need to use the homes we have more effectively, and we need to fund services properly to treat people with dignity and respect. We need to ensure that we create homes that enable people to become rooted in their communities and provide the workers and families we need to help keep local communities thriving. In rural areas especially, we lose homes to the holiday and second home market, as has been discussed already. In Argyll and Bute and the Western Isles, 6% or more of housing is second homes. In Orkney, it's 5%. Of the more than 24,000 second homes in Scotland, 3,000 are in Argyll and Bute alone. And that is why the Scottish Government was right to regulate short-term lets. That is why we have introduced stricter planning rules on holiday properties. And that is why we are working with councils to bring empty homes back into use. We need systemic change to put people and housing first. The social housing and not-for-profit sector are addressing this challenge in innovative ways. In Inverness, I visited Highland Housing Alliance's incredible retrofitting work on the Merchant's House, transforming a derelict building in the heart of Inverness into affordable, energy-efficient homes. And meanwhile, Albans Housing's Bailey Place development has created brand new, highly efficient homes close to active travel networks with a real sense of community. And I've also seen the pioneering work carried out by the Communities Housing Trust, working with community land and development trusts and estates across my region to build high-quality, affordable homes that respond to local needs. From Staffin to Strontian, Tyree to Tomintel, communities are filling the gaps created by decades of underinvestment, starting long before devolution, and using Scottish Government schemes like the Scottish Land Fund and the Rural and Island Housing Fund to deliver them. What Scotland's housing sector needs is long-term solutions and a cultural change away from housing as an investment to one that creates homes for all of our people. It's deeds, not words. And in conclusion, Presiding Officer, that's why Greens in government will strive to ensure everyone in Scotland has a safe, affordable and warm home, and that our rural communities remain places to dwell as well as places to visit.
Thank you, Ms. Burgess. I now call on Jim Fairley to be followed by Mercedes Weber. Mr. Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, there is no doubt that there is a housing crisis in some parts of Scotland, and it is without doubt the biggest issue that my office deals with. But as Ben McPherson said, this is a UK-wide issue, and he eloquently outlined the reality of what that situation is. But to the motion, that the Parliament agrees that Scotland is experiencing a housing emergency. That, Presiding Officer, literally sums up the ambition that the Labour Party have. One line of doomsday nothingness. Where is the ambition? Where is the hope? And where is the belief that things can and must get better? Where, Presiding Officer, is the fully funded, costed and detailed plan about how to change what they see as a housing crisis? Would any of that be too much to ask from a party that sees itself as the change that Scotland needs? And I hope they will answer those points in their summing up. Grandstanding pontification with this insipid, lacklustre and quite simply insulting to this chamber nothing of a motion, Presiding Officer, absolutely deserves the derision that this chamber and the people of that this country, that Labour and Scotland tell us they've won the trust of in the coming election. Put that in stark contrast to the track record of this SNP government as set out in Minister Paul McLennan's amendment. And the people of Scotland very quickly realise exactly who it is that looks after the people of Scotland's interests. We know there are issues to deal with. We know that homelessness is a scourge in our society. And we know that we must do more and think creatively to find workable solutions. And in this minister, I am certain that he's got the ability, the tenacity and the willingness to find those solutions, implement them and help us to help those who need those homes the most. I have to say, well, there are things that are in the Scottish Land and Estates briefing that I agree with, like there has to be a partnership approach, particularly to rural housing. I think there is a distinct lack of acceptance that some of those estates' culpability in helping to create the issues of rural housing shortages. In my constituency and across Scotland, it has been a heartbreaking thing for someone like me who was desperate to find a rural house, witness the emptying and degradation of literally hundreds of old cottage houses as estates cleared staff and those houses fell to rack and ruin. So I very much welcome the £25 million rural affordable housing system that has come from the Scottish Government. So by all means, let's have a better, positive relationship with estates because they will have a role to play. But spare me the holier-than-thou attitude that it's all the Scottish Government's fault, because it isn't. There is a problem. So let's take the collective responsibility to make sure that the solutions are forthcoming. Let's have the ideas, but also let's have the honesty that John Swinney talked about what it is that we have to do in order to make this housing crisis better. I would urge caution, however, and this is another point I agree with Scottish Land and Estates, that speed should not negate the need for quality or lack of consideration of the potential for unintended consequences. And on a slightly different note, I'm going to say Scotland has a 15% of its land as non-LFA. That means good quality grade 1 and 2 arable land, the kind of land that grows our most valuable foodstuff, tatties, wheat, barley, salad, berries, veg, neeps. That's what we grow in those fields. But it's also the easiest ground for builders to build at speed on. And a number of people have asked today for easier planning, but we have to make sure that that competing demand has to be reconciled and balanced out so that we maintain a viable, vibrant food-producing industry that can continue to feed our nation. And the same principle applies to planting trees. Yes, the right tree in the right place has enormous value, but we must value and protect our best arable land at all costs. If we don't, who are we going to ask to feed us? A presumption of brownfield site development is something that should be considered to protect our arable future, notwithstanding what SLNE said are the challenges that those brownfield sites bring. My final point, Presiding Officer, is that using that creative thinking to reimagine what the modern-day requirements are And city centres with their abundant empty buildings like Debenhams Building in Perth City Centre could be repurposed and developed to bring people back to the COVID-vacated centres and create thriving city centre communities, which in turn will give a rebirth to businesses that will grow with the population. We have numerous other derelict or empty properties throughout my constituency, ex-councillor police stations like in Crieff and Ochterarder and Kinross. They could all be repurposed, removing the blight of empty properties and helping increase the number of available homes. I can see a genuine positive vision of where our vision or where our housing and house building sector can add enormous value to our economy, our skills development and our aim to eradicate homelessness. I can see that necessary collaboration that SLE and others are looking for, and I see all of that ambition and vision in this SNP government. What I see from the motion from Labour, presiding officer, is a single line of nothing that should tell the people of Scotland all they need to know. That Labour and the Tories will simply not deliver. This SNP government will. Thank you, presiding officer.
Thank you, Mr Fairley. I now call Mercedes Bialba to be followed by Stephen Kerr. Ms Bialba.
Thank you, presiding officer. I refer the chamber to my register of interests, which shows I am a member of Scotland's Tenants Union, Living Rent, and of Acorn Community Union. Presiding officer, I'm speaking today in support of the Labour motion that the Parliament agrees that Scotland is experiencing a housing emergency, as has been declared by Edinburgh Council and as I urge Dundee Council to declare. Because, presiding officer, there is a housing emergency in Scotland and tenants are on the front line. And despite the rent freeze, Dundee has seen a shocking 17% rise in private rent prices. That's 5% more than the Scottish average because of loopholes in the legislation. In fact, property investors are describing the city as Scotland's buy-to-let capital. And property prices have shot up, driven by the potential to profit from a basic human right. This picture is mirrored across Scotland. Thousands of people in temporary accommodation, thousands on social housing waiting lists. And properties at or below the local housing allowance rate are scarce. And the private rental sector is capitalising on overwhelming demand for homes. Presiding officer, this is an emergency, and it has been building for years. Members will remember when I brought the campaign for a rent freeze to this Parliament. They'll remember the Scottish Government's fierce opposition to the proposal, and they will remember how this Government was forced to U-turn and introduce emergency legislation thanks to national public pressure from Scotland's tenants. That legislation should have seen us through to the promised national system of rent controls needed to bring rents down. Instead, more than a year later, as we approach the end of this temporary legislation, loopholes continue to be exploited, rents continue to rise, and rent control legislation is nowhere in sight. Tenants are facing persistent issues of mould, of cold, of damp, of disrepair, and of the constant possibility of being evicted so their landlord can sell, all while rents continue to rise. So how is this happening? Presiding officer, we know that those in joint tenancies have faced unregulated rent increases when a flatmate leaves, as it's often considered to be a new lease. This loophole is resulting in a de facto eviction for remaining tenants who can't afford increases of hundreds of pounds a month. Landlords are also increasing prices dramatically for new lets to supposedly future-proof against the rent cap, causing spiralling rises in the market that we're seeing. This is pushing prices up, it's forcing overcrowding, worse living conditions, and increased commutes as people have to move further and further away from where their life is. We need measures that protect those in joint tenancies, that protect those in arrears, that protect those who are being priced out of their communities. Strong, long-term rent and eviction controls have the potential to protect those on the lowest incomes with the least ability to absorb extra costs and the highest risk of homelessness. And we need those rent controls now. Presiding officer, we've heard this government making promises to tenants for years. We've seen the publication of consultations and strategies and commitments on housing. What we're missing is action. So I welcome the Minister for Tenants' Rights' commitment to the Housing Committee that the government will bridge the gap between the end of the emergency legislation and the introduction of longer-term rent control measures. But we've yet to hear how this will happen. And without this clarity, tenants are facing a cliff edge at the end of March, at which point there seems to be nothing to stop landlords hiking rents even higher. We need a rapid response to this emergency, one that's watertight, that's permanent, that's effective and transformative. But it begins by recognising the problem. We are in a housing emergency. Tenants are on the front line. If the Scottish Government refuses today to even acknowledge that, what faith can we possibly place in their ability to address it? So I urge all members, whatever their party, to support Labour's motion that the Parliament agrees that Scotland is experiencing a housing emergency. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Biamba. I now call Stephen Kerr to be followed by Willie Coffey. Mr. Kerr.
Deputy Presiding Officer, it is actually refreshing to debate something in this chamber that is really and genuinely a priority of the Scottish people. And so I commend the Labour front bench for bringing this debate to this chamber. And I wish the SNP Green government were willing to spend more time discussing matters like this rather than some of the nonsense, the fiction, that they prefer to waste the time of this chamber with. Because I believe the national conversation about housing epitomises what is so wrong with the system in our country. I actually thought that one of the best speeches we heard, other than from my colleagues on this side of the chamber, was from Kate Forbes. There are things about the system that need to be reformed, and reformed quickly. Because for as long as I can remember, there has been cross-party consensus on the need to build more and better houses. The question we should be asking ourselves today is not if we should be building more houses. We all know and agree on the answer to that, but why we as a nation are unable to build sufficient homes to match demand. Yep. The current levels of homelessness in this country are a national disgrace, and the increasing levels of homelessness rest solely at the feet of the minister who wishes to intervene. And I'm not going to give way to the minister who's trying to intervene, because I said to him earlier, and I stand by this, that homelessness in our country has been made much worse by this SNP Green government's staggering lack of insight, their addiction to ideology, their ill-advised approach to the rental sector. Because despite expert warnings, they have pressed on with measures which have brought great distress to many individuals and families. When it comes to building houses, we must properly investigate where the system is failing. The first problem is land. Yep. The process of repurposing brownfield land is too slow and is too costly, to the point that it is not economically viable to build on. Yep. We must work with those in the industry to make this process more efficient. We're all aware of neglected buildings in our respective constituencies. And rather than sit back and allow this to continue, leading to dereliction and local eyesores, there should be a mechanism which allows councils and private companies to repurpose these buildings or knock them down and build anew. So I'm in favour of compulsory sales orders and an end to the reluctance of councils to use the authority at their disposal to improve dereliction or gap sites. The second problem is planning. We need to change the culture of planning officers. There's not enough of them for a kick-off. That point was made earlier. But communities and developers need planning officers to become advisors, supporting building, facilitating rather than blocking development. We need to see an end to the farce of endless planning permission, which leads to the blight of vacant and derelict sites, such as the one at the distillery site at Bank Knock in my constituency, where a large-scale planning application was approved in 2009 for nearly 4 hectares of land, which remains on Falkirk's register of vacant and derelict land. It's not good enough. And we need to include local people. Communities know. I will give way.
Daniel Johnson.
I'm very grateful to the member for giving way. It's not just the nature of planning. It's also, I think Kate Ford's made an excellent point about the time it takes. And indeed, I think that's a point that Michael Gove agrees with too. Does he agree with it?
Stephen
I agree with that. I mean, no wonder people give up. No wonder people leave. No wonder people stop investing, because the whole process is frustratingly expensive and frustratingly elongated. But I'd like to return to the point about the need to engage with local people. Communities know their local areas best. They know the impact of developments on roads, on schools, on health services. Local people should feel empowered to voice their concerns, and developers should work with communities to mitigate these concerns. When we mock people for NIMBYism, we should acknowledge that such attitudes exist partly because the system is defective. The minister has a brass neck to try and intervene on any of the speakers in this debate, because he took not a single... Well, did you take any interventions at all? I don't think he took a single one. Maybe one. I've taken one. We need to cut red tape. And rather than developers having to navigate war and peace regulations, there should be concise, clear guidelines. But building new housing is not enough. It's already been mentioned. It is a national disgrace that many Scots live in inadequate, damp and energy inefficient spaces. So as well as the drive to build houses, we need to have an equally committed national mission to improve Scotland's housing stock. Housing isn't just about bricks and mortar. Poor homes can impact health and family life. And I'm coming to a conclusion, so I'd love to have, but we just don't have enough time to debate things properly in this chamber. There is further consensus that we must improve the energy efficiency of our homes. Let's find the money to do this. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, we have a national housing crisis. Not only do we not have enough homes, but we also have too many inadequate homes. We need to build, we need to improve. Everyone in Scotland must have a home worthy of the name.
Thank you, Mr Kerr. And I now call Willie Coffey. Mr Coffey.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer. It's always good to start off a contribution with some positives in the debate, and there are plenty to share. By 2032, only 9 years from now, this SNP administration will have overseen the building of 234,000 social and affordable homes in Scotland. 124,000 have been delivered since 2007, and another 110,000 are on the way, with 70% of these to be earmarked for social rent. In Scotland, we've built nearly 14 homes per 10,000 population in that time, a fact mentioned by several colleagues. That's a good record, and it outperforms any other nation in the UK, especially in Wales, where Labour has been in power for so long but has managed only around half that total. Indeed, in my authority area, Labour managed to build no council houses whatsoever during its 8 years in power in this Parliament. None at all. Zero. But it did manage to sell off vital housing stock and also hand vital cash back to the UK government from time to time that it could have invested in housing in Scotland. The SNP in government ended the right to buy council houses in 2016 and has saved around 15,000 council houses from being lost to the public social rented pool, while Labour and councillors all over Scotland was happy to sell off vital housing stock, following the Tory mantra of selling anything that could make a quick buck. In fact, since 1979 up to 2015, in Scotland, an incredible 494,580 council houses and social housing stock was sold off. That's 14,000 houses lost every year for 35 years. All lost. If we're in an emergency situation in some parts of Scotland, then it has its origins there, and Labour and the Tories might want to reflect on their role in this before coming here to blame the SNP for their massive sell-off. No doubt, Presiding Officer, we are facing a number of challenges. Skyrocketing costs brought about by inflation and the problems associated with materials costs made worse by Brexit are driving up construction costs and making it harder for people to access the various housing markets. But we're doing what we can to overcome them and support the programme going forward. But I want to turn, Presiding Officer, to my own council in East Ayrshire and share some of the positive achievements and ambitions that the council has for the future. Indeed, only this morning at the council's cabinet, which includes Labour councillors, met to discuss a number of housing strategy papers, and they supported all of them with no exceptions. No mentions of an emergency at all, not a peep from Labour councillors about an emergency in East Ayrshire. A curious contrast with other messages that we're hearing here. Since 2010, East Ayrshire under the SNP, there's more to follow. I'll come in, I'll let you in if I get some time. Since 2010, East Ayrshire under the SNP has built 585 council houses, including other registered social landlord builds. The total is around 1,000. A remarkable achievement, and having seen the quality of their builds, the Council and its partners should be commended for this work. I'll give way to Mr Johnson if he wants to come.
Daniel Johnson.
So, when you're saying what councillors are saying in some parts, would you acknowledge that SNP councillors are saying that there's a housing emergency here in Edinburgh, the capital city?
Willie Coffey.
Absolutely do. But maybe you want to have a word with your Labour councillors in East Ayrshire, because they haven't got the message. They laugh, you like, they didn't mention it. It's not just the numbers that matter, though, Presiding Officer. It's about things like regeneration. It's about well-being. It's about climate change and energy efficiency too. The council is now building its fourth supported living complex with units adapted with warden support, meaning that one tenant in particular now has a home who was 31 years in hospital and residential care. And there are plenty of other similar examples. A major development in the north of Kilmarnock has seen 44 new council housing units completed to a high standard, winning a design award in the process. In the south of the town, a development in partnership with the local housing association is nearing completion, with every house being energy efficient with heat pump technology installed too. And there's another development, which is the first carbon zero development to be completed there. These examples from East Ayrshire, Presiding Officer, show what is being done and can be done to meet our targets and to meet our other obligations. Presiding Officer, it's always a pleasure to talk about housing in the Parliament or anywhere else. I was my group's spokesperson for many years when I was a member of the Council in opposition. During that term, we wrestled with the problems of dampness and mould, poor heating systems and zero insulation, often overlooked by a Labour administration that didn't act fast enough to correct this, even when it had the resources to do so. In looking at where we are now, I'm extremely proud of the achievements of my colleagues in local government in East Ayrshire, led by my friend and colleague, Councillor Dougie Reid, who has championed this work for so many years. They have delivered for their communities, and they still are, and hopefully will continue to do so well into the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Coffey. We will now move to closing speeches, and I call on Brian Whittle to close on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Up to 6 minutes, please, Mr Whittle.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to close this debate on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. And can I thank Labour for using their debating time for bringing this to the Chamber? And can I thank Mark Griffin for highlighting at the start of his speech that this is an emergency of the Scottish Government's making? Scotland has a housing emergency. Across the Chamber, there is acknowledgement of that fact. In our briefings from so many organisations, there is consensus that Scotland has a housing emergency. And with this customary forensic analysis, my friend and colleague Graham Simpson cut to the chase when he highlighted no one should have to sleep rough. No one should have to use a night shelter. And in that alone, they do, and that makes it an emergency. Except, of course, if you're trying to defend the Scottish Government position. We see the usual obfuscation of reality, publish a target without detailing how that target will be reached, then rolling back on that target and saying it's not our fault, as we heard from Kevin Stewart. Nothing to see here. Of all the damning evidence stacked against the Scottish Government handling of this emergency, denying there is an emergency, blaming it elsewhere, just will not cut it. You can't begin to tackle a problem unless you not just now. Like, you can't begin to tackle a problem unless you first acknowledge the scale of it, as Mr. Simpson reminds us. Furthermore, Scotland's homelessness deaths numbers is shameful, and it's linked, I would suggest, in no small part to our drug and alcohol crisis. And as the previous First Minister said, she took the eye off the ball, and I would suggest that is what's happening here. Douglas Lumsden highlighted the chaos the Greens' policies have brought to the Scottish housing market. The affordable renting stock has plummeted as landlords leave the sector after the Greens' ideologically policies decimated the sector. Far from preventing rent rises, they have caused massive hikes in rents. And I say to Ben McPherson, many house builders looking to build affordable housing in the rent-to-buy space have decided not to proceed. See, I will.
Ben McPherson.
Does Mr Whittle acknowledge that actually there is strong interest in cities like the communities I represent to undertake a variety of developments, including build-to-rent, and that the Scottish Government is looking to implement its long-term system of rent controls? That certainty is what the market's asking for, and then the buoyancy will continue.
Brian Whittle.
Thank Ben McPherson for giving me that intervention, because it allows me to say that the reality is that the Greens and SNP do not recognise outcomes, because if they don't agree with their extreme ideologies. And here's a fact. Here's a fact from Mr McPherson. In 2018, for every rental property in Edinburgh, there were 6 applicants. There are now 24. There's now 24. Now, Pam Gosse pointed out that the upcoming housing bill has a mechanism to finally give direction to a directionless government housing strategy. And she articulated her meetings with the chief executives of local council have highlighted the increase in homeless applications and a lack of housing stock being the biggest issues facing the housing market. As my friend and colleague Stephen Kerr, in an impassioned speech, stated, homelessness in Scotland is such a scourge. And he quite rightly says, why do the SNP Greens continually fail to build enough housing to tackle this crisis? And he also points out that the woeful planning laws are preventing that progress. Now, climate change, Willie Coffey raised climate change, and I would like to talk about that. With a finite budget and with the stated twin goals of reducing energy bills and reducing a carbon footprint, which will help homelessness, especially for those in the lowest SIMD areas, can I suggest that a targeted investment to improve stock is one of the ways forward? What the Minister should be doing is using funds to improve the energy efficiency of social housing, build many more energy-efficient, social and affording homes that would tackle homelessness. And let's face it, Scotland has some of the worst energy-efficient homes in Europe. Furthermore, if the target is also to reduce our carbon output, then investment in those rural houses off-grid, including oil-fired heating system, would make the greatest initial impact. This would also help to tackle the huge shortage of rural housing, as Kate Forbes highlighted, which I thought was a really excellent speech. Instead of that, we have a housing minister who stands up in this parliament and says, we're going to retrofit 1 million homes in Scotland. Well, I asked the Scottish Government through PQs how many applications have been made to Home Energy Scotland grant and loans this year. The total, 6,000. The number of offers that were made, 1,900. And I looked through the local authority areas, and in the look at some of the poorest places in Scotland, for example, Inverclyde, the total number of applications, 7. So that's great. 999,993 to go. Fantastic. We're well on the way there, Minister. Now, I was at the Energy Efficiency Conference with some colleagues a couple of weeks ago, and this is some of their asks. They said that approvals and payouts need to be sped up and backlogs need to be reduced, and it's as simple as that. Companies can't call HES on behalf of customers due to GDPR, and the backlog is causing salesmen to quit as they can't wait 4 months to be paid because they're on commission. The demand for the sector is there, but the way the government has the funding set up makes commercial viability poor. This is due to cash flow for the grants. Having a poor cash flow means that these companies can't grow and recruit despite the demand. And south of the border, the wait is 5 days. 5 days. The government needs to pay it forward so that builders can make sure all new builds have that renewable technology. The cost can't solely be on the builder, passed on to the customer. It's not affordable and contradicts the government's affordable home strategy. Last week, I asked the Minister for Higher and Further Education of the Scottish Government and completed a skills mapping exercise prior to setting these targets. Unsurprisingly, in the response, the Minister responded that the government is, and I quote, currently engaged with ministerial colleagues across government to map the skills shortage. Well, let me tell you what the skills shortage is in the building industry. 22,500 tradespeople short to hit government targets. 22,500. It makes a mockery of the targets that this government set. Now, I will, presiding, to close, presiding officer, I think this epitomises a Scottish Government approach that delivers headlines without that roadmap. That Scotland has a housing crisis is beyond doubt, despite any continued protestations from the Scottish Government. It's time this fact was recognised and accepted, and until they do, how on earth can they possibly begin to practically tackle another Scottish Government crisis? I urge the Chamber to support Graham Simpson's amendment. Thank you.
I now call on Patrick Harvey, Minister, up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thanks to all members for taking part in this debate. With a number of notable exceptions, there were some members who brought well-reasoned contributions to the debate, positive, constructive ideas and an understanding of the causes of the challenges that we face. And we have been asked, we should all ask ourselves to reflect on how people who are experiencing significant housing difficulties would view our debate. People in temporary accommodation, people on housing waiting lists, people in homes that are damp or in poor repair, people who are struggling to meet housing costs. Mr. Griffin and others were right that there are still far too many people in those situations, and this government has a determination to put that right. People at the sharp end of these challenges need to hear that determination, but they also need to see action. So I'm most grateful to those members whose speeches were focused on solutions. Mr. Griffin's speech, unlike his motion, called for a focus on action. It's actions that build more homes, make existing homes better, and keep costs affordable. And that's why the government amendment today focuses squarely on that action. Last October, I'll give away.
Mark Griffin.
I appreciate that the government want to set out the action they plan to take to tackle the crisis. What I don't understand is why they've deleted the entire motion to add the government's own actions. Why not acknowledge the emergency that exists and then set out the actions that you plan to take to address it? What is the government's problem with accepting that it is there?
Minister.
We believe that the actions that need to be taken are the only things that will make a difference. And last October 2022... we did take emergency action to support people who rent their homes. The Cost of Living Act introduced restrictions on rent rises while a tenant remains in the same tenancy and strengthened protection against evictions. Well, it's perfectly clear that the Conservatives still would rather that we ignored the needs of tenants, but the Act has continued to provide important additional protection for tenants across the rented sector. Anywhere else in the UK, private tenants have faced the double impact of unfettered rent rises both during and between tenancies. So I was very pleased when this Parliament voted to approve the regulations that extend the provisions for a further and final 6 months period until March. I give way.
Brian Whittle.
Very grateful for the Minister for giving me. Much as I accept that the policy was brought in with good intentions, does he not recognise that in Scotland, 14% increase in the last year is greater than it is in London at the moment?
Yeah. Minister.
The Member is talking about increases in advertised rents, so that's new tenancies, and those have been increasing at comparable levels in other parts of the UK, as well as in other parts of the UK, those tenants facing increases within their tenancies. But the emergency legislation is, by definition, temporary, and that's why we've committed to introduce longer-term rent controls in a housing bill that we'll bring to Parliament in this parliamentary year. And I'm continuing to engage with stakeholders and other colleagues on the shape of that bill. The scale of private rent increases across the UK demonstrates the need for action to tackle rent rises. And it's clear from across Europe that where greater regulation of renting and of rents is the norm, such regulation can and should go hand in hand with encouraging investment in improving both quality and supply. In addition to our proposals on rent control, we're currently considering 8 policy areas for further rented sector reform, some of them aiming to improve the experience of renting and enhancing the rights of tenants, one of many areas where action is needed, both in Scotland and UK policy. We'll press ahead. I'm afraid I do need to make a bit of progress. We'll press ahead with measures to increase housing supply and work in partnership to maximise the use of current housing stock. We'll introduce new homelessness prevention duties this parliamentary year that will offer stronger protections than anywhere else in the UK. We'll strengthen rights for tenants and offer greater security from eviction. We'll bring forward a new housing rights bill. I need to make a little bit of progress to set out the action that we're taking. A new housing rights bill that will incorporate the right to adequate housing into Scots law within the limits of devolved competence. I just want to recognise as well that we have been pressing for some considerable time by the UK to end the freeze on local housing allowance. And I'm relieved today that the Chancellor has finally given in to that pressure and scrapped the freeze on LHA. It's an important source of support for low-income households. It should never have been frozen in the first place. And the damage done by 3 years of that freeze is an estimated £819 million cut to the allowance across GB, coupled with cuts of £181 million to Scotland's capital budget, and it's hampered efforts to increase available housing. I sincerely hope that a freeze like that is never considered again, because no one should have to make the choice between paying their rent, feeding their family, or heating their home. I want to be clear as well that the scale of homelessness and inadequate housing is one of the big challenges that Scotland faces, by no means unique in that. And for example, statistics show a 74% rise in temporary accommodation in England over the last 10 years. Doesn't absolve us by acknowledging those wider contexts, doesn't absolve us by any means from taking action, but we should be clear about that wider context. In 2023, we are not where we should be. But to listen to some members, some from the Conservative Party and some from the Labour Party, you'd be forgiven for thinking that these housing issues exist in Scotland only. Brexit continues to cast a dark shadow over our construction industry. I know some of them don't want to hear it. Over our construction industry and workforce capacity, the pandemic, followed by a cost of living crisis topped by a disastrous experiment with far-right economics in the Truss Kwarteng mini-budget, has put a huge strain on our resources. And all too often, it's the people with least to fall back on who are hit the hardest, the same people already hit by a decade of austerity and brutal welfare cuts, the people who are in temporary housing accommodation or in the poorest housing. So that's why we here in Scotland are determined to do all that we can to turn that tide. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I do want to say that our programme of actions to tackle these issues, if we offered this programme to colleagues in England, whether that's Labour campaigners, housing organisations, that programme of 120,000 affordable homes over the last 15 years, getting rid of the right to buy, ending no-fault evictions in the private sector, introducing an emergency rent cap, bringing empty homes back into use, enhancing homelessness rights. If you offered that package of action to those elsewhere in the UK, I think people would bite your hand off. So we will continue to be open to positive, constructive ideas, whether from Labour members or anywhere else in the chamber, about how we can continue to make greater progress. That's what people in the most difficult housing situations in Scotland need. Action, commitments, and that's what this government is determined to continue to deliver.
Thank you, Minister. I now call on Daniel Johnston to wind up the debate for around 8 minutes.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. There is a housing emergency. That's not really up for debate. The choice this evening is whether or not we want to acknowledge that crisis, that emergency, treat it as such, because it's only with that acknowledgement that we'll treat it with the urgency and the focus that it deserves. I think the tragedy of this afternoon has been there was an opportunity. There was no need for the government to disagree with what we had in front of us. It could have been an opportunity to have that frank discussion about how we tackle these problems, looking at the solutions and coming together with a degree of consensus. And indeed, I think there's been quite a strong contrast between the front bench and the back bench contributions from the government benches this afternoon. I think that we've had some of that thoughtful discussion from the SNP back benches. Unfortunately, we've not had it from the front bench. In fact, they want to wipe out the word emergency. Apparently, all we're facing is significant pressure, and only amongst those who are homeless. Tell that to private renters in Edinburgh. Tell that to anyone looking for a house. Tell that anyone to facing homelessness. It's not significant pressure. It's an emergency. But the other critical problem with what the government has presented this afternoon is it actually fails to really acknowledge the fundamental problem. They've talked about initiatives. They've talked about conversations. Fundamentally, we have a problem of housing supply. Now, if you slice that and the dice that, you look at particular categories, you will not acknowledge the full problem. And the simple reality is this. On average, the SNP have built 5,000 fewer houses than we did when we were in power. Between 1997 and 2007, 230,000 were built. Between 2007 and 2022, 260,000 homes were built. In other words, under the SNP, it took them 15 years to build as many houses as we built in 10. That is the simple reality. If we had continued to build houses at the same rate when we left power, there would be 104,000 more homes in Scotland than there is today. Those are what the simple numbers tell you. Happy to wait, Mr.
John Swinney.
I'm grateful to Mr. Johnson for giving me the only slight flaw in the contorted information he has just given to Parliament, is that it ignores factors such as the financial crash in 2008, which led to a hemorrhage of private building, which had nothing to do with the Scottish Government and everything to do with the financial mismanagement of the last Labour government
Daniel
in the
Johnson.
UK.
There is a serious point here. These are the simple numbers. I didn't make any attributions. I said that you have to acknowledge that the fundamental point of supply, and unless you recognise that, you will never make progress. And the simple reality is, and I think Sarah Boyack put it very well, is that at the heart of these numbers is a human experience. I think the fact that she raised that 45% of homeless people face severe and significant mental health consequences is something I think we should all be reflecting on. And I have to say, it's something I think about a lot during my surgeries. And I hate the fact when I am faced with people living in cramped accommodation, families of five or six living in two-bedroom flats, and I have to tell them, because of the points on the Ed Index system, that they're going to have to wait years. It's inhumane. And until you fix supply, that will continue to be a problem. And it's why you have to face up to the emergency, face up to the fact that a family is being made homeless every 16 minutes in Scotland. And I think there was a number of excellent contributions. I thought Ben McPherson's contribution was absolutely spot on, because we're not going to address this crisis unless we look at all the issues. And there is a global context. There's a historical context. There was a move away from building social housing through the 80s and 90s. And perhaps he's right. You know, I think we could have done more when we were in power. I mean, it's only by facing up those things that we can deal with this in a crisis. What I don't understand is why so many of his colleagues will acknowledge that this will feel like an emergency to so many, and yet don't want to recognise it as an emergency in this hotel. Happy to give away.
Paul Sweeney.
I thank my friend for giving me that point. He's making an excellent speech. One of the great strengths of Labour is housing policy in Scotland during the 1970s and 80s was building the Community Housing Association movement, which is increasingly seeing forced mergers, directed mergers at the behest of the Scottish housing regulator. Does he share my increasing alarm and concern at this trend in Scotland, most recently with Reid Vale Housing Association in Denniston?
Daniel Johnson.
I do indeed, and I think housing associations have faced an absolutely invidious position in recent years, finding it very difficult to invest in their housing stock. And critically, again on the numbers, fewer housing association dwellings have been built under the SNP on average per year than were under Labour. But, and I also would thank Kate Forbes for her thoughtful contribution, and she's absolutely right. We do need to talk about solutions, and I don't think I disagree with a single one of the ones she set out, but in particularly on the planning point. Because yes, I think our members across the chamber have acknowledged the fact that there are financial pressures and there is a reality there, but there are also systemic pressures that we could relieve. We have to acknowledge the fact that the number of planners has dropped by a third in recent years. And until you have throughput in the planning system, we will struggle to approve the schemes we need to. Happy to give way.
Kate Forbes, yeah. Briefly.
I just wonder, in the spirit of consensus, that the member would agree that one of the key concerns I have is that when a community group in particular is, for example, progressing plans for affordable housing, they often have to jump through the same hoops as a major corporate, for example, and we should ensure it's easier for them to get through the process.
Daniel Johnson.
I would absolutely agree with that. I think thinking about the throughput in the systems, making sure that we reflect the priorities, whether that's particular groups. I would also acknowledge the point that this is about, in the broader planning process, you know, strategic infrastructure. I think treating all planning applications as the same, I don't think makes sense, and we need to look at that. And members across the chamber were asking, what are Labour solutions? Well, let me just gently remind them. We have made a commitment across the UK to build 1.5 million homes over 5 years. We will create a national infrastructure commission that will, through partnership, ensure that we lay the bedrock for that. And we will ensure that house building and reform of the planning process is absolutely at the heart of ensuring that we can deliver those plans. And we will bring similar plans for here in Scotland. But the simple reality is that nothing that the ministers have brought forward this afternoon really acknowledges that anything needs to be done differently. The motion and what they have said basically points to what has already been put in place, the plans that are already in effect, and saying that everything is fine. But the numbers tell you they are not fine. But they can't even decide on what numbers they want to choose. They disagree when we talk about private sector housing, yet the 130,000 figure that they quote includes private sector housing that they don't want us to talk about. It is a total nonsense and it's total confusion. And the simple reality is that the actions taken by the government are not enough. The housing situation and the crisis points to that, and until you fix supply, you will continue to have those problems.
No, Mr Johnson, I think you're beginning to...
The simple reality is, what we have heard from the government today is a set of excuses. Government is not about excuses. It's not about dodging the problems. It's about acknowledging the problems and coming up with an action plan to deal with them. We've had none of that, nothing new from the government benches today. You know, there's been some questions recently about the mooted rebuttal unit that the SNP needs. They've already got it. The Scottish Government's sole purpose seems to be rebuttal. The problem is they're not very good at it. Whereas the Tories we have the chance of getting rid of in the coming months. Unfortunately, we're going to have to wait 2.5 years until we can get rid of this sorry government. And until then, I am ashamed to say Scotland's going to have to put up with a government that seeks excuses rather than delivery. And that will be felt most when it comes to housing. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Johnson. That concludes the debate on Scotland's housing emergency. Point of order, Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. On a point of order, I seek your guidance as to how parliamentary process can be correctly followed to secure answers on the £11,000 Michael Matheson iPad scandal. On behalf of our constituents, we have tried repeatedly to get answers from this government and this Parliament. Yet since last Thursday, we have been frustrated at every turn. Mr Matheson has referred himself to this Parliament's corporate body, but yesterday, the self-same body said that no such process actually exists. Topical questions have been rejected. Urgent questions have been refused. Debate requests have been dismissed. A request for a further statement received the response that such a statement would be inadmissible, and all the while, the facts keep changing. The lesson, Deputy Presiding Officer, from all great political scandals tells us that the cover-up is often worse than the crime, and it is now abundantly clear that the SNP are in an industrial cover-up, closing ranks to avoid the truth getting out. We have it on record that the First Minister, the Deputy First Minister and the Health Secretary have all misled this chamber in recent times, and nothing has happened. No corrections, no apologies, no proper investigations. Deputy Presiding Officer, I cannot understand how this meets the obligations of our standing orders, which ensure that the code of conduct is followed by members, regardless of how senior their position in government. To our constituents watching at home, this Parliament appears totally toothless, whether on the iPad scandal or the deleted WhatsApp messages. Words and standards apparently count for nothing for this SNP government. The Health Secretary has been accused by journalists of lying to the Scottish press. This chamber and the Scottish public deserve to know the truth on this charge. But sadly, it is increasingly clear that Scottish ministers are hiding behind this Parliament's rigid rules and inflexible timetabling to evade investigation and interrogation. In summary, Deputy Presiding Officer, I seek your guidance as to how this Parliament can compel the evasive, scandal-hit Health Secretary to answer key questions on an issue that has rightly enraged our constituents and the entire country.
Thank you, Mr Hoy. In response to the point that you have raised in relation to the SPCB, it is indicated that self-repel is not possible, but it is also indicated that it is due to meet tomorrow to consider the matter further and will issue a statement following that meeting. In relation to the Code of Conduct, as the member will know, that is a matter that is agreed by Parliament, but it's for the Standards, Procedure and Public Appointments Committee to consider and report the adoption, amendment and application of any Code of Conduct for members, and any revisions to that, I think, have to be agreed by Parliament on the basis of recommendations from the committee. And therefore, I think if Mr Hoy has concerns, he may wish to consider writing to the convener of that committee. And in terms of the business of this Parliament, again, as the member will know, that is a matter that's agreed at Bureau, and he may wish to consider speaking to his business manager about that. And where a business motion is brought before the Parliament, as will be amply demonstrated shortly, there is an opportunity to speak against that business motion.